gracia del Señor, que a un infeliz salvó.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Welcome to Epworth United Methodist Church this morning. I'm Pastor Kristin Stoneking, and so grateful that you are here on this day. I know that God has beckoned you here for a reason, and so I pray that you will experience that grace, that assurance, that love that is found here, and that you are asked to take out of this place when you leave at the end of the service. If you're new to Epworth, I want to say a special word of welcome to you and invite you to sign one of our Connect cards. You can find that in the pew rack, or you can do that online at epworthberkeley.org/connect. If you'll sign one of those, that will allow us to put you into the communications loop and let you know everything that's happening in this vibrant community of faith. Later in the service, I'll share with you some of the ways that we are responding to God's grace and love in this world. And I want to make sure you have all of the details about that. We'll be praying today through prayer cards. And so that's another place where you're asked to lift up those places where you're celebrating, as well as those places where you may be suffering. That we could hear each other in voice and hold each other in prayer in the week to come. If you are experiencing a particular loss or transition, I want to invite you to let me know that so that I can connect you with one of our amazing Stephen ministers who are trained laypersons who are prepared to accompany you in this season of change in prayer and in spiritual friendship. So let us worship. God fortifies us with collective wisdom. The Spirit infuses us with creativity. The living Christ opens our hearts to possibility. So let us press on towards liberation. Let justice roll like a river and righteousness like an ever-falling, never-ending stream. God is with us, and God hears our cries. I invite you to stand as you are able, in body or in spirit, as we sing our opening hymn, Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior. It's number 351 in your United Methodist hymnal.
Savior, hear my humble cry. Good morning. My name is Peter Ngong, and please join me in this responsive prayer printed on your bulletin or visible on your screen. We come to this worship lonely or empty or frightened. We come from households spiky with anger. We come from unfinished projects, ruined plans, and multiple irritations.
We come from broken lives, hidden dreaming, unanswered mail, and a week without bedtime prayers.
We come from nuclear paralysis and a refusal to read the newspaper for fear of learning how we might help someone.
From inadequacy, we see God's wholeness. From limitlessness, we see God's forgiveness. From self-imposed impotence,
we hope to be free for love and service by the gospel's power. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. May God bless you all. My name is Carlos Altamirano, and I'm going to be doing the reading scripture today, which is in the book of Colossians, chapter 1, verses 1 to 14. Miss Kellie couldn't make it today because she's sick, so I'm covering this spot. Okay, our prayer for her. So Colossians, chapter 1, verses 1 to 14 says, "Greetings from Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus. I am an apostle because that is what God wanted. Greetings also from Timothy, our brother in Christ. To the holy and faithful brothers and sisters in Christ who live in Colossae, grace and peace to you from God our Father. In our praise, we always thank God for you. He is the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank him because we have heard about the faith you have in Christ Jesus and the love you have for all God's people. Your faith and love continue because you know what is waiting for you in heaven, the hope you have had since you first heard the true message, the good news that was told to you. Throughout the world, this good news is bringing blessings and it's spreading. And that's what has been happening among you since the first time you heard it and understood the truth about God's grace. You heard it from Epaphras, our dear friend and co-worker. He is a faithful servant of Christ for us. He also told us about the love you have from the Spirit. Since the day we heard these things about you, we have continued praying for you. This is what we pray, that God will make you completely sure of what he wants by giving you all the wisdom and spiritual understanding you need. That this will help you to live in a way that brings honor to the Lord and pleases him in every way. That your life will produce good works of every kind and that you will grow in your knowledge of God. That God will strengthen you with his own great power so that you will be patient and not give up when troubles come. Then you will be happy and give thanks to the Father. He has made you able to have what he has promised to give all his holy people who live in the light. God made us free from the power of darkness, and he brought us into the kingdom of his dear Son. The Son paid the price to make us free. In him we have forgiveness of our sins." Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Susan Jardin, Director of Children and Family Ministries and Older Adult Ministries. And kids, come on up and help me give my children's message today. Thank you, Ronan. Hi, Juliana. Welcome, yeah. Hi, nice to see you. So guess what? I'm not perfect. Can you believe that? I am not perfect. Are you guys perfect? No. How about you guys? Are you all perfect? No. But you know what? That's okay. Nobody expects you to be, right? I like to think of myself as a work in progress. Do you know what that means? A work in progress? You can kind of think of it. What do you think a work in progress is?
So, like this painting, it's not finished.
Like this painting, it's not finished. This is a work in progress, right? Can you see that I've started to paint the flower in and the background and the vase, but what's missing?
The other flower.
The other flower. I haven't decided yet how I'm going to paint that flower. And you know, knowing me, I might change the background. It might end up being a different color, and the vase might have more design. I'll try to make it better, but it's not done. And we're not done. I used to think when I was young that when I finished school, I would have arrived. Like, this is it now. I know everything. But I realized that when you finish school, that's kind of when a lot of your learning starts. And that's okay, right? We will continue to develop and grow all of our lives. That's one of the beauties of life, is there's so much still to learn at any age. But you know what? God loves us where we are all the time. It doesn't matter how developed we are, how finished we are. We are beautiful in the eyes of God no matter what, no matter where we are on our journeys. And that's something I hope you'll remember, and it's something that helps me get through each day. Let's pray together. Dear God, thank you for the comfort of knowing that we are secure in the promise that nothing can ever separate us from your love. Thank you for your perfect love that seeks the best in our lives. Thank you for loving us as we are, wherever we are. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's go to godly play.
As our children head to godly play, I want to invite you now to stand where you are and bow to those around you, offering each other the peace and the grace that is ours, knowing that we are loved wherever we are on the journey. Amen. Thank you, choir. Thank you, Jerry. Will you pray with me, please, the words of preparation which are printed in your bulletin or on your screen? Gracious and loving God, may the words of my mouth be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, this last week marked the beginning of my sixth year here at Epworth. I am so grateful for these past 5 years and the opportunity to have been in ministry here with you. And as I look back, there's so much. We've started so many small groups. Some were just for a season. Some have continued. Just this last Lent, we started 9 small groups. And one of those that I convene, the parents group, meets just before worship and continues to be a source of strength and grace to me. And I want all parents to know we meet in the library, so you can join us. We've accepted 40 new members in the last 5 years. We've accompanied 12 individuals, either in singles or as families, through the sanctuary Nueva Esperanza ministry in a close kind of accompaniment, in a daily walk, in a number of different ways. One family even living here in the church for a year during the pandemic. We've launched a multifaceted racial justice initiative, and we see evidence of that in the sanctuary today, and I'll talk more about that later in the service about how you can continue to get involved and take action. We've added 5 new Stephen ministers to our vibrant cadre of Stephen ministers, and you know, there was a time, I think it was Ash Wednesday, when the Stephen ministers were meeting right before our Ash Wednesday service, and we had just begun the service, and they all came in, and I felt like our own Supreme Court was arriving. We've offered 15 different camps for all ages, and we've supported a vibrant children and youth and older adult ministry. We've witnessed to our community, our commitments through art. We've even finished the last 4 years with operating surpluses. So these are just a few of the highlights about all of the many things that are happening here at Epworth. And oh yeah, we also weathered a pandemic, not just by maintenance, but in ways that helped us grow and learn and reach out to our community in brand new ways. I'm so grateful to God and for what God has made possible through Epworth, and for the blessing of being on this journey with you. Your service, your commitment, your creativity, your faithfulness, your perseverance, your honest sharing of your joys and sorrows and longings, your mutual encouragements and accompaniments have been key ingredients in all of this. I'm proud to be a pastor of Epworth, and I'm proud of you. Thank you. It's so great to look back on the sweep of all of this, because I confess to you this morning that the truth is, on a daily basis, on a in-the-moment basis, there are many times, in fact, sometimes it seems like most times, that I feel inadequate to fulfill all that must be done to respond to the needs of our community and our congregation. I worry that I haven't communicated things well, or that I haven't prioritized the right things. One of the benefits of the new hybrid worship age that we're in now, you can participate in worship online. You can do it on Sunday mornings. You can do it later in the week. And one of the benefits of that is that I too get to hear many sermons a week. I listen to my colleagues preach, and as much as I love hearing them preach online, sometimes I come away comparing myself to them in a negative way and feeling like, well, that's a level I'll never reach. So, and maybe you have similar times when you're faced with the gap between your hopes and your vision and the reality of what is. Well, John Wesley, too, and to some extent his brother Charles, felt this sense of inadequacy and the gap between vision and reality. It's part of what drove John and Charles to arise early during their time as young men at Oxford University and study the scriptures and pray and hold themselves and their other group members to strict accountability in their practice of faith. It's part of what drove them to the American colonies. They wanted to do something big and even sacrificial for God. And they hoped for a sense of assurance that they were on the right track. But as you may know, their time in the colonies was not a success. Charles left after less than 6 months, and John did not last more than 2 years. Moreover, John left under the cloud of some level of scandal, as a woman whom he'd been courting married someone else, and then he vindictively denied her communion while simultaneously refusing to stop trying to visit her. Her new husband, who wasn't John Wesley, wasn't pleased with all of this and wrote out a bill of charges, at which point Wesley decided it was time to get back to England, and he got on the next ship. And when he arrived, those who had sponsored his trip said, "What are you doing back here?" And in many ways, in the days that immediately followed the return to England, this could have been considered the lowest point in John Wesley's life. And when Charles's return too, he kind of entered this trough of spiritual struggling after the expectations and the hopes of what might happen in the Georgia colony didn't work out as they had imagined. On the way to the American colonies, originally on board ship, John Wesley had encountered a group of Moravians, a sect from Germany whom he greatly admired for their persistent faith. And during a furious and dangerous storm at sea, you may know this story, this storm that caused the rest of the passengers, including Wesley, to fear for their lives, the Moravians calmly sang songs of faith without concern for what was happening around them. What John witnessed in them, as inspiring as it was, also caused him to feel deeply inadequate. And upon his return to England, the Moravians and their seemingly content and confident faith continued to compel him, but also caused him to question if he had any faith at all, if he was even a Christian. Well, the Moravians believed in instantaneous conversion, which is to say, as Peter Bowler, one of their leaders, put it, that in an instant, one could come to an assurance of faith that through the merit of Christ, one's sins are forgiven, that one is loved and reconciled, and receive the peace of that insurance. This could happen in an instant. And Wesley began to study this idea and proclaimed it not only scripturally grounded, but presently possible. This idea of instantaneous conversion is so fascinating to me because it does bear some similarity to the Buddhist notion that enlightenment can happen in an instant. It can happen for one just beginning on the path of the Dharma or one that has been following the path for some time. And John Wesley yearned for this kind of assurance, but he didn't believe he had it or had experienced it. And though his brother Charles initially scoffed at this idea of instantaneous conversion, within a few weeks of hearing this idea, Charles is said to have experienced it himself. Charles was struggling spiritually, and he was sick in bed, and he was said to have sat up and said that he felt a strange palpitation in his heart and proclaimed, "I believe, I believe." And he said after that moment, he himself found peace with God. Well, poor John. He had not experienced what he yearned for and what others seemed to be talking about, and he described himself as in a continued state of sorrow. And his brother Charles and some of their Moravian friends told him they were praying for him. Then, 3 days later, John decides to go to a Moravian Bible study on Aldersgate Street in London. And you likely know this story as well. He enters reluctantly. He's not interested in going to a Bible study that night, but he kind of forces himself to do so. And he finds the group studying Luther's preface to the epistle to the Romans. And as he hears the testimony of the change that God works in the heart through faith, he finds his own heart strangely warmed and understands himself to be in the full grace and love of God. He realizes that the solution to his nagging and sometimes even debilitating sense of inadequacy is to recognize that inadequacy is a given. And he's accepted and loved and forgiven anyway. Our scripture today is from Colossians. And it's the opening verses of the letter to the new Christians at Colossae. And scholars say it might have been written by Paul, or it might have just been written by someone else who was imitating Paul. It uses the same opening form as the letters that have been authenticated as Paul's, opening with the words, "Grace and peace to you." This was a typical greeting of Paul's and an atypical greeting in a letter at that time in antiquity. But there is enough doubt that New Testament scholars continue to debate the question of authorship of the letter to the Colossians. Of course, Paul's letters carried authority and respect, so it's not surprising that if this isn't Paul, the writer who wanted to communicate with the church at Colossae and wanted to be read and wanted to be listened to would imitate Paul. The other side of using Paul's name, of course, is that perhaps the writer didn't feel that their name was enough, not up to the task, inadequate. And yet that's what's so interesting about the letter. The letter doesn't describe a state of spiritual struggle such as Wesley went through while wrestling with his sense of inadequacy. The letter is about joy and thanksgiving. "We give thanks to God for you," the writer says. "We've heard that you have faith in Jesus and that the gospel is bearing fruit in you, just as it has been doing among you since the day you heard it and truly understood God's grace." Since the day you heard it and truly understood God's grace. Friends, I give God thanks for you too. And when you are feeling inadequate, flawed, somehow not enough, I implore you to turn towards God's grace that assures you that you don't have to be other than who you are to live in the abundance of God's grace. In fact, the beauty of God's grace is that we're actually expected to be flawed and imperfect. As Susan said, we're all works in progress. We're not God. God knows that, but sometimes we forget it. And when we do hit the mark, it's a gift, not because of our own merit or effort. Now, this might seem like a simple truth, but really, the reality is that it's countercultural and even counterintuitive thinking with the way that the world has taught us to think. The world is always encouraging us to put ourselves out there, to be more, to do more, to become perfect. But the beauty of this message, the beauty of the gospel, the beauty of God's assurance and grace is that it's not necessary. We are who we are created to be in our imperfection, and that is exactly how God loves us. And yet this simple truth that we are wonderfully flawed humans. This is the key to letting go and falling back into the loving and open arms of a Savior. In our inadequacy, in our inadequacy, we are perfectly adequate. Trust this. Believe this. We are justified by faith. It's grace that's brought us safe thus far, and grace will lead us home. Amen.
Son of God enfold you with his spirit and his love. Let him fill your heart and satisfy your soul. Oh, let him have the things that hold you and save like a dove. Prove to him of all you and make you.
Amen. As a community brought together in faith, we have the opportunity to lift up those places where we're celebrating, where we're experiencing joy and really feeling the flow of the energy of grace through our lives and through our bodies, as well as those places where we're struggling, where we're grieving, experiencing loss, as well as just those times of uncertainty and a deep sense of not being enough. And as we lift those places up in voice, we know we're heard, we know that we're accompanied in the week to come, and we trust that the grace and love of God will flow through us in this time of community prayer. And so as I lift up each prayer that has been submitted in our prayer cards, I'll respond, loving God, and then I invite you to respond. We lift our hearts to you. Maria Gallo reminds us that the Stephen Ministry will be at the chapel after the service. And so if folks would like to have private prayer with a Stephen minister, you can do that just outside this door and in the chapel. Loving God,
lift our hearts to you.
Melanie G. lifts up prayers of gratitude and gratefulness for Biden's executive order to protect women's rights after the recent Supreme Court decision. Loving God. Prayers asked from Jeff Bruno, prayers lifted up for his father and their family as they plan to move Jeff's father into an assisted living facility in El Cerrito. Loving God. Glenn Eagleson lifts up prayers of celebration for Randall Miller's mom's 88th birthday. Loving God. Prayers are lifted for Kathleen and her memory issues. Loving God. Misty lifts praises to God for giving us holy love, and may we love ourselves and others in the universal language of God's love. Loving God. And prayers always, Misty asks for her family, with God's provision and holy health. Prayers for traveling mercies and connected connection for us all. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Loving God. Maria lifts up prayers for her friend Virginia in New Mexico, mourning the loss of husband Justino on Tuesday. Loving God. Prayers of gratitude for our reconciling committee. Loving God. Susan Jardin lifts up prayers for the family of Tony Littlestone, who passed away suddenly from cancer yesterday. Prayers especially for her son, Adam. Loving God. Prayers of gratitude that Jan R. celebrates 45 years of sobriety today. Loving God. Woo! Amen. We lift our hearts to you. Prayers for Reed, who is looking for a beloved pet. Loving God. Mary Cavagnaro lifts up peace and love for the children and family of Charlena Lyles as they cope with the new and the news that a member, a member at the inquest judged her death at the hands of police as a justifiable action. May peace surround and hold them. Loving God. And Michelle lifts up love and congratulations to Tom and Jean Olson, who are celebrating their 68th wedding anniversary today. Yay! Loving God. Let us take all of these prayers spoken, as well as the ones that remain on our hearts, to God together now as we bow as one. Oh, dear God, we come before you this morning with such fullness. So much to celebrate in our lives as we celebrate decades of commitment and faithfulness through thick and thin, as we celebrate decades and scores of years in life as we mark birthdays, as we celebrate the love and grace found in this community, as we share and support one another in our walk with you. And dear God, we also lift up those places where we are struggling, where we're mourning, where we face again the injustice of the taking of one's life being held with no consequences, where we face the limits of our physical bodies and the limits of the physical bodies of our loved ones. And dear God, we also bring before you the turbulence in our world, the uncertainties that we face, and the hopes that we have for peace. Help us in all of this, dear God, to lean back and rest in your grace. Help us to feel your loving arms around us, loving us in the depth and the reality of our human condition. Help us to know that our inadequacies are not just okay, but expected, and so therefore free us, dear God, to live as free people, your people, who are powered by the energy of grace. We lay all of this before you, dear God, knowing that you are with us and you walk with us as you showed us in the life of your Son who came to us as you, but as one of us, to live an earthly life, to suffer what we suffer, so that we would know that you understand. And in that, he taught us to pray. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Live in the grace and love of God, we're compelled to respond. We're compelled to keep drawing even closer in our sense of nearness, in our sense of union with who God is and where God's Spirit is acting in the world. Wesley called that sanctification. And another way of talking about it is just responding in love. There are a number of ways that you can do that this week through the ministries of Epworth. One of those is coming right up. One of the families we have been accompanying will be part of our camp this week, but they will be needing some assistance with rides from North Berkeley BART up to the church. So if you are a person who could do a shuttle run each day this week, Monday through Friday, either at 9-ish, a little before 9, or 3, or both, just stopping by the church to grab the car seats and then heading over to the BART and bringing them back up. Please talk to Christina Kellogg in the coffee hour. She's got a sign-up sheet, and we'll look forward to being able to fellowship and support this family through camps this week. At the same time, the mom of this family is going to be making some meals this week. So if you would like to support them by purchasing a meal, as kind of a takeout dinner, also let Christina know that, and she'll be taking a list of folks who want to participate in that way, eating amazing Guatemalan food. Second, after worship today, the Racial Justice Action Meeting will be convening, and everyone is welcome and encouraged to come after coffee. It's actually after coffee hour. Grab some coffee and something to eat, and then we'll gather in the fellowship hall at 11:45. You'll have noticed that the Beyond February exhibit has moved from an external witness into an internal witness. The tributes are still being put up, so if you don't see your tribute up, not to worry, there's still an in-process dimension to the tributes that are emerging into the sanctuary. But, you know, sometimes when things are up in the same place in the same way over time, and these have been outside on witness on the Hopkins Street side of the church, we stop seeing them. And so we hope that you will now see the tributes in new ways. The contributors are doing further research to update, and you heard one of those updates, not the update we wanted, but still an update in our prayer time today. Thank you, Mary Cavagnaro. And we also invite folks to continue making these tributes. These tributes remind us that we have both a responsibility to an external witness for racial justice and an internal witness. And so as we look internally into our own culture at Epworth and how we can be a truly anti-racist community, these tributes help us to stay accountable and remember one way to be active. In the Racial Justice Action Meeting, we'll also look at 7 other ways that we might be able to continue to be active or new initiatives to take on. So I do hope that you will come to that today. It's both available in person and online, so there is a hybrid option if you are joining worship online today. And finally, well, actually, 2 more things. Our Reconciling Committee is meeting tonight at 6:30, moved from a typical time in the afternoon to the 6:30 time, Fellowship Hall. All are welcome. And this is a big plea from me. I will be accompanying our youth to Sierra Service Project July 24th to 29th, and it turns out we need a second adult who can drive during that week. So if you have a heart for youth, want to serve in a beautiful place, we'll be at the Smith River, please talk to me after worship today, reach out to me in any way. I'd love to share more about that with you. You can also respond to God's grace and God's love through a gift, a financial gift to the ministries of Epworth, and you can do that online, or you can do that here in the sanctuary at the offering box in the narthex, or through the mail. Thank you for your generosity. Let us give. Amen. Will you pray with me, please? Holy Spirit, forgive us when we have not been able to recognize the path towards solidarity. Forgive us when we have not been able to relate to our neighbors with compassion. Forgive us for prejudices that still have hold on our hearts. May our offerings be a sign of our desire to do the work required of love. Use these gifts, dear God. Amen. I invite you to stand now in body or in spirit as we sing our final hymn, Blessed Assurance, number 369 in your hymnal. Now may you go out from this place in the name of the one who gives life, in the name of the one who came so that we might live and live fully, and in the name of the one who breathes life into us even now. Go in peace. Amen.